thank you all for coming to see. I think this is our sixth or seventh, or tenth, having a continuation of it. And I'll read the posting. So the Board of Appeals will hold a public continuance of a public hearing in the Great Room at Pleasant Street Centers, 49 Pleasant Street in Reading, Mass, on Thursday, January 24th, 2019 at 7 p.m. on the petition of Eden Lakeview Development LLC, who seeks a comprehensive permit to develop 86 units of rental housing and 4.33 acres of land that is partially in residential zone and partially in industrial zone under the Master Laws Chapter 20B, Section 20 through 23. With waivers from zoning requirements for the property comprising of six parcels no max. We've got 0 Lakeview Avenue, map 17, lot 131, 0 Lakeview Avenue, map 18, lot 2, 23 through 25, Lakeview Avenue, map 18, lot 1, 0 80 Eagle Street, map 17, lots 274, 0 Eagle Street, map 17, lot 275, and 128 Eagle Street, map 17, lot 276, in Reading, Massachusetts. All the people in this room have been sworn in previously, and one of the others that I recognize and hope that I stand with you. If you remember our last meeting, we were not at full capacity of 5 members. We only had 4. We discussed this with Jesse and the management team and decided that we would be moved to both the town and the development team to give continuance for a period of time. I just signed that request of continuance this evening, gave it back to Chris, our town council. So that will go forward. At least we are not fighting that aspect of it. But in all likelihood, there's a good possibility we will be through by the 22nd. And let's see where we go from there. There's a number of things that have come in to the town during the period of 2 weeks that we've been out, or we haven't had a meeting. Andrew, do you want to go back over that?
Yes, gladly. So the last time we really officially met and had a full meeting was December 12th, which we then reviewed revised engineering plans and architectural plans from the applicants. They submitted their loading and parking plan, the snow and ice removal plan, and we had released the scope of work for the Walkersbrook Drive corridor study. Since that date, the applicants have again revised their engineering and architectural plans to, and which they will go over any changes that they have made tonight. They have worked and met with the Conservation Commission 3 to 4 times, I believe, which is now closed. It was closed last night. The Conservation Commission did that. And we have officially finished the scope for the Walkersbrook Drive corridor analysis and received the estimate for that, which will also be discussed tonight. And since then, the applicants, staff, and town council have been back and forth on the draft decision, working together on the language there, and that too will also be reviewed tonight. And from there.
In addition, we have the architectural plan updated.
Yes.
For the changes in the number of units, which you will go over this evening. Well, I think the first part of the hearing might be to put on record that which we have new that we can discuss before we will be over and get comments back again as we go. So I assume we're going to take over.
Yes, yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is Jesse Schomer of the law firm of Northeast Stereo. We have made a small change to the plans, and that's what that's the reason why you have the new stack of plans. Trees in the area. So what we've done when we were looking at the numbers after the conversion of the project from the all rental to the half rental, half townhouse, the numbers were getting a little bit close to the marketability and fundability of Guy, the developer, he went back and spoke with Ed Marchand, who's our 40B consultant, and they looked at ways to get it over the line again. So what they came up with is to convert 12 of the one-bedroom units, which I believe are 4 in the 2 smaller rental buildings and 4 in the larger rental building.
All in the small?
Okay. They converted 12 of the one-bedrooms into 2-bedrooms, basically. And in order to do that, they had to pump out those buildings by about 10 feet. We looked at the change. We went over that with Chris, the engineer. And he reviewed the numbers with Matt Broussard, the peer review engineer. Our understanding is that there's only minor revisions to the stormwater report. There's no change to the traffic report because the traffic counts are based on units. So it's really just a very minor change. We will need to update the waiver list when we get to that point. But that's basically it. That's the substance of the change. It's very minor. Both the engineer and the architect are here to answer any questions.
Jesse, you said about the 10-foot bump out, and that is on the three rental units. So we're talking about the 2 smaller buildings and 2 large buildings we're talking about.
Andrew?
Yeah.
Yes,
please. Andrew, could we?
I did hear it came to the
problem.
Okay.
Thank you.
There is a microphone there.
Yeah, I'll.
Can you hear us in the back, Gene? Are we audible, or should we use the mic?
My concern is for the...
Is it on the left?
Press the button. I think the microphone is most helpful for the recording of the meeting, since it's not being broadcast live tonight. We want to make sure that the recording is picking up the audio.
Right.
I think there's a joke somewhere. How many engineers, architects, and lawyers did they
Stephen Griffin from Stephen Griffin Architects in association with Curtis Deepin and Iowa Architects. So the change that we were making occurred to the 12 unit buildings. So essentially, these 2 smaller rental buildings here on the site. So within the units, the ones here, the stack that's up here and the stack that's here were one bedroom units. So there's three floors, so it would be 6 units in each building. They were just one bedrooms before, so essentially we bumped the building out 10 feet to accomplish getting another bedroom in for those units. And then on the site plan, which is not up here, essentially the buildings bump out an extra 10 feet and they just slide a little bit to accommodate that. So it's minor site movement of the buildings to accommodate the extra 10 feet of the building move. And the elevations, essentially nothing really changed with the elevations, it's just the gap between the gables kind of a little wider to allow for those extra bedrooms to come in. So essentially the architectural feel stays the same. And that's really the crux of the changes.
The number of units have not changed though.
No, the total number of units are still the same. It's still 12 townhouses and 74 units of buildings. So it's 12 in each and 15 in the big building. It's just that 6 or 12 ones went to 12 twos.
Other questions? Those changes reflected then in the draft decision that we put together to talk about?
Yes, so we recalculated the units to match what occurs here now, so they should be all up to date, and the site plans as well are up to date as well.
No other questions on the presentation, sir?
No, I don't think, I'm looking at the date on these plans, though, and it does say October 24.
Correct, so the plans that didn't change stayed the same. So I was trying, okay. I only updated the plans that were, these three sheets in the middle, you'll see have a different date on.
Okay.
So I want to make sure that we weren't confusing with, for this submission, you didn't see a whole new set and try and find the changes on every sheet. Just the sheets that were updated were dated that way. I think the final submission for the draft will date it all at one time.
Oh, okay, that's what I was gonna ask. I don't care if it is, but then if that's the case, we need a revision block on it with the latest revision.
Right.
And because we do want to have the latest plan
correct.
Reference
yep.
in the comprehensive
yes,
permit.
Correct, absolutely, yeah. Yes.
Okay.
And this will come in at the same time as the control documents for the rest of the project, which is in our draft decision, which is only specified, but not, we don't have a date for that.
For
the control plans, including our particular plans to come in. That's at the end.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. Normally, I wouldn't open this up to. I'm going to have to mix and match for the public input in here, only because it lets you wait until the end and it'll be all confused. So if there is any questions for the applicant, again, please stand, raise your, give us your name and the address and ask a question.
No, this is good. So to answer your question, the buildings are here. Essentially what we did is the bump outs really push the buildings, or pushed out towards the sidewalk. We needed to leave this basically alone because if it ever did become parking again, we have to keep the width. So it's the same width between, the same width right here, stay the same. Otherwise we wouldn't be able to build parking at that point if we needed to.
Yes. Tommy DeRosa, 130 Jones Street. How does the change in the number of single bedroom units affect the affordability of the project?
It's still governed by the same regulations under 40B. The units have to be mixed throughout the unit count and the bedroom count and throughout the apartments. So there's really no, it changes where they have to be located in reference to each other, but it doesn't make any difference in terms of the number of units. It's still going to be 25%.
I have one other question for you too. What's not specified in the draft was where these affordable units are going to be located, both in the apartment areas and within the condo. There's three affordable units in the condo section on Eaton Street. Are you going to, you talk about that a little bit of a change,
yeah.
Are you going to be able to give us that? Because I think that would be appropriate, especially when you go to mass housing, when they go over it, we don't want things coming back.
Right. So to answer directly, the answer would be yes, because part of what we also have to do is locate the accessible units as well. So there has to be a mix of accessible without, you know, between unit mixes and between all the buildings, and also between normal units and affordable units. So essentially I need to go through and say, okay, how many ones are, you know, accessible, how does that mix through the floors vertically and horizontally through the site, and how does that work with the portals? So yes, we're going to have to show a plan that shows all of that.
That's going to be on the updated.
Yeah, we can do it. We can do that for the for this. That would be fine.
Good. I'm Brad Rivers, 94 Eden Street. Multiple questions actually. So, how does changing the one bedrooms to the two bedrooms affect the park?
It actually. It actually doesn't, because it's based on units. So some towns do parking by bedrooms. Town of Reading does it by units. So we haven't changed the unit count. So,
that's not going to push you towards having to build out this parking instead of the parking park?
Not any more than the other.
Okay. And so where the two buildings separation, right, that's exactly the same distance apart as it was before?
Yes.
Except you described before there was 10% and you slid them over a little bit. 10 feet added on.
So, we slid them. Essentially what happens, the 10 feet is added right here. And because the buildings did grow a little bit, to keep this distance the same, the buildings slid a little bit more to the left.
So, they slid further apart?
Yep. Essentially where they were located before, once I added the 10 feet, they were, it kind of, how I was shifting it, pushed it a little bit into the thing. So,
I understand.
You're not seeing. There's no change at this point. Essentially, once we've resided everything, the 10 feet really is added here, and it really gets to the end, closer to the edge of where this building is. Okay.
So, part of what we went through last summer, right, with the neighbors going to visit the development team and so on, was to try and have mass away from the street. Right, to make it still consistent with the neighborhood. And now you've pushed much more, right, onto the front part of this lot, into the street.
There's 10 feet more horizontally of building.
Yeah,
it hasn't gotten any taller.
By three stories higher,
yeah.
Right, closing off, right, the whole idea was to make that transition, right, similar to the rest of the neighborhood and the street,
mm-hmm.
Right? And this seems antithetical to that kind of agreement that we made last summer between the developers and the neighbors. So, comment?
I can comment a little bit. We really, as you said, we work with you, with the neighbors a lot, and we are happy to do that. When it came down to it, though, doing that and removing the large building on Lot A and moving those to townhouses, that really it changed the financial makeup of the whole project and took it really close to the line for us. So unfortunately, it was a financial necessity to get more units, and the only way to do that.
Are you going to share that with the board? This financial thing, because the whole notion is that basis. Right, becomes part of their jurisdiction if that's the claim that's being made. And so, are we going to see that kind of calculus?
It's typically not done at this point in this process, being that this is, you would call this probably a friendly, what we would call
I still want to be friendly. I mean, there's no question about that. It's more trying to understand the drivers and why some of the things that we agreed to now and in good faith came and we worked to achieve at this very late stage of the exercise now kind of goes a little bit against what we thought we had worked towards to achieve to come to this agreement and be on site. So I'm not trying to be kind of confrontational here. I'm trying to kind of get an understanding and have everybody appreciate sort of this kind of change of the balance a little bit, okay?
I understand the sentiment, and if it could have looked exactly like we showed it to you last summer, we would have been great with that. But unfortunately, the reality pointed us in this direction. And it's not ideal that we're having to do this at the last minute, and I understand the perception that we're putting it on you at the last minute. We're really not. We're getting it to you just as soon as we got it ourselves. So.
Okay.
So we think that this is a good balance still for the neighborhood if they are slightly bigger, but there is still the same transition from the townhouses to the mid-rise to the larger building in the back. So we think it still works, and we hope the neighbors still do think the same.
Well, we'll think about it. Thank you.
Jesse, just a quick clarification. The two units in the two buildings in the front are still at the three-story level.
Correct, yes.
They have not changed.
No.
Since you came in with the original plans for the move.
Correct.
The one in the large building in the back is a four-story.
Correct.
Okay. The change that you have this evening is a bump out of approximately 10 feet, which you're going to, that's going to show on the updated plans.
Correct.
On both buildings out towards the parking area, not affecting the inner circle of projected pocket parking, or whatever you want to call it, but
correct.
That's still to be resolved. Okay. I want to address the affordability of that aspect of it, I think. So I'm going to go to Chris here, town council, because Chris is not just working on 240Bs around here, he's also working on 40Bs. He's very much involved and knows how mass housing works. And as I said early on, we want to make this so that when it comes back, and it has to be approved, that's the first step after the draft decision and the decision is signed. If mass housing doesn't approve it, it comes back to us anyways. So, Chris?
Sure, only the comments I think I'd add at this point are, in terms of the overall affordability, I think the change to the unit mix would also just affect with the number of units of each bedroom type of affordable. So if they want one for twos, that would affect the number of two bedrooms that would be included in the affordable units that they're providing.
And that's correct, we've done that calculation.
And the only other comment I'd add is in response to the comment, would the board review the financial analysis that is driving this change? The board, in the ordinary course, the way things stand right now, in the ordinary course would not be provided that information from the applicant. The only time we see the financials at this point in the hearing is if the board is looking to impose a condition that the applicant challenges and says, if you impose that condition on the project, it will render it non-economic and we can't go forward. At that point, they would need to provide the supportive financial information to show that the condition would in fact render the project non-economic, but it's not something that they would automatically have to provide the report in the hearing unless we got to that point of fighting over the performance of the post.
Okay. And let me ask you a question, Chris. Recently, I don't know how many years ago, we used to have an organization called CHAPA. CHAPA would review the financials of the applicant coming in to them so that it meets their standard of profitability on any project. We no longer have CHAPA per se, or do we?
I don't know. I haven't seen CHAPA involved in a hearing in a number of years. Not recently. There are certainly still financial analysts who could provide guidance to the board if and when it got to that point in the hearing. So in other words, if we did have that scenario where the board is looking to impose a condition, and the applicant said, no, you can't do that, that'll render the project non-economic. Here's the information to support that. The board can then hire a consultant who either would be CHAPA or somebody who would have worked for CHAPA a couple of years ago. The board can hire a consultant, just like it hires a civil engineer or a traffic consultant. You could have somebody come in to double check their numbers. So yeah, those consultants do exist in the 40B world. They work for zoning for ZPAs. But that process only gets triggered when the board is looking to impose a condition that they have to object to.
I have a question. I'm interested in what the net increase is in the affordable units. I'm also interested in the affordable home ownership ones. Now that some of them are going to be in the apartment complex, does that mean some of the townhouses, how does that affect
No, it doesn't. So the overall count of affordable units does not change. The mix, whether they were ones or twos, does change. The townhouse had to be actually, because it's going to be sold off, has to be considered separate. So those counts on the townhouses did not change at all.
But 25% of the affordable, of the townhouses are affordable.
Yes, correct.
Right?
Yes.
So now that you have to move towards the units in the apartment complex.
We always did, but yes.
Right, but now they're both their ownership units in the apartment complex, right?
No.
They're not,
no.
Okay. So none of that's changing?
No. So the essentially the units that are, the 12 townhouses up here are all going to be for sale, market value, you know, ownership units.
Okay.
All the units here are just apartment rentals. So that does not change.
So then what's the net increase in affordable total units then?
There's no net increase from before. No, because the unit, before we had 86 units.
Yeah.
We haven't changed it, we still have 86 units. We just have more twos than ones now. Before they were a little bit more balanced, so there's a little bit more twos now.
So okay. There should be a net increase in the number of two bedroom affordable.
And that's absolutely correct, right. Yes.
Okay.
We have some other info that came in, and I'll ask Andrew to address it. One came in from Chuck, Conservation.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to read into the record that letter or that memo?
Yes. So as I had mentioned, Conservation had closed their hearing yesterday. Which they will render a decision and order conditions in by their next meeting, I believe, but I'll read Chuck's memo to get his wording. At the end of last night's four-hour meeting, the Conservation Commission closed on the notice of intent for Lakeview and Eden. On February 13th, our next meeting, the Commission will issue a permit for this project. Within the order of conditions, the applicant is required to provide an environmental monitor, reporting back to the commission weekly on any work within the 100-foot buffer zone. The tree inventory shows 26 trees on the southwest side of the site along the bank of Walker's Brook will be removed with zero replaced. After much discussion, it was agreed the applicant and commission will work together to vegetate those open areas along Walker's Brook with grasses, shrubs, and trees. Please get back to me if you have any questions.
And that, in essence, will give us somewhat of a closure towards the actual decision on the CONCOM section of the project.
Yes. Yep.
And that you've been working with the, and Chuck has been working with the applicant to finalize.
Mm-hmm.
We just don't have that yet, but it needs to come in. So we still have some time. We need to move along and get the rest of these documents. Full documents in, and that's what's taking time to get it done. Okay. We also had something else in the actual plans that Chris provided to us in his letter. I think that, well, correct me if I'm wrong, well, don't correct me if I'm wrong. Tell me where we stand on that. I guess
so. The Chris you're talking about, Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Okay.
I didn't know if you could come up next or if.
Sure. Yeah. For the record, Chris Spiradis from the Engineering and Survey Office of Williams and Spiradis. The chair is correct. We submitted a revised set of site plans. We have been working with the commission over our last three hearings. We did an extensive tree inventory and some other items that required us to revise the plans. You may recall at our last meeting back in December when we went through the civil engineering pre-review and our responses, there were some outstanding issues with regard to the some things that the fire department, the police department, and engineering wanted us to add to the plans. All of the items that were requested were added to the plans. I could go through the list very quickly if you'd like, Mr. Chair, just for the record.
Yes, please.
Okay. So the Conservation Commission requested that we do a tree inventory of all the trees between the wetland line and 100 feet from the wetland line. And it was it took us quite a bit of time to do that. to document how many trees are in that zone and then how many of those trees would have to come down as a result of the development. And so much of our deliberation with the Conservation Commission had to do with the trees, the tree inventory, and then some specific questions on certain trees. For example, you may recall that along our northern boundary that we share with number 114 Eaton Street, the single family home, there were, are a couple of trees along the property line there. And we documented the species of those trees, and the Conservation Commission asked us if we would be willing to save those trees, and where we had the row of arborvitae, skip an arborvitae where one particular tree was to incorporate that into the design, which we did. They also asked us to work cooperatively with the neighbor should the need arise to remove that tree if it becomes sick over time, that sort of thing, with the understanding that if it did die, that it would be replaced in kind with another arborvitae to sort of complete that spring on that side of the property. We added retaining wall details. The Conservation Commission wanted us to provide on the plans a couple of options for retaining walls. We've discussed this with the Zoning Board of Appeals in the past in previous hearings. The options that that are on the plan allow the developer to choose between a stone and masonry wall, which would be natural stones with cement, or modular block walls. And depending on where you are on the site and whether or not that is a wall that would be seen by the public or by a neighbor, it'll be more decorative in nature. If it's something that's facing the wetland, maybe not as much of a concern. Street sweeping was added to our operation and maintenance plan. The snow storage areas were updated. This is something that we've already presented to the ZBA. This came out of a comment from Matt Broussard regarding, he wanted to make sure that when snow melts from areas that were snow storage, that snow melt came onto the parking lot surface so that it would be treated before flowing back towards the resource area. And so that required us to eliminate some small snow storage areas that were sort of sloped away from the parking block areas. So we also documented that for the Conservation Commission. On buildings, one of the buildings, the four unit buildings, this is the townhouse side of the 12 units. This is the building that contains units 9, 10, 11, and 12. The decks that are on the back of this building are relatively close to the wetland, and the Conservation Commission was concerned about animals being confused if the lights that were installed on the decks shine too brightly towards the woods. And so we specified a particular lamp and fixture for those four units. That information was added to the photometric plan. It's a non-glare type fixture with a relatively low wattage. The tree inventory plan also identifies trees to be saved, which is something that the Conservation Commission wanted us to identify. The tree inventory is detailed on multiple sheets, including the landscaping plan, to give the reader a very good understanding of the trees that are to remain. We added a fire hydrant as requested by the fire chief. Let's go back to the utility plan. There's a new fire hydrant located in this corner. In addition, after speaking with the town engineer, the town engineer requested that we replace the existing hydrant that's at the end of Lakeview Avenue here. So we're going to take that little one off and put a new hydrant on that. Fire department connections were also updated to comply with the specific requests of the fire department. They are located on the 12 unit buildings on this side here, on the outer sides of the buildings for easy access for fire department should they have to park near the building. And then the back of the project for the larger building, the fire department connection is also on the outside here. And then for the four unit buildings on the townhouse project, we created a small doghouse that would house the sprinkler control system and would provide access with an exterior door for the fire department. The driveway width associated with our one-way driveway here that was 18 feet in width, we bumped it out to 20 feet in width to address that comment by the fire chief. We also labeled all of the curb radii as was requested in each one of our turnouts. At our last meeting, we had talked about the loading zones and whether or not we could try to find a way to physically fit one that was 12 feet by 35 feet and dedicated, if you will, within the parking lot area. We had shown a couple of areas, you may recall, that were shaded in this location here and this location here. However, the fire chief commented that it was going to impede or intrude into a 24-foot wide aisle. We sharpened our pencils a little bit, and we come up with a way to configure a loading space, as a dedicated loading space on the west side of the property at this location here. And this measure is 35 feet long by 12 feet wide and does not encroach into the driveway aisle. And so we have a dedicated loading space here, and then as described in the parking and loading plan, we have four spaces that are going to be a secondary area that could be cordoned off during the daytime, as we talked about back in December. The police department requested that we have stop signs at this location here, and I believe at this location here, those were added to the plan. And finally, we have ongoing discussions with Reading Municipal Light Department regarding the placement of transformers for the project. We've been speaking directly with one of the engineers that we've worked with before in the past, John Duong, and he's working on the design and the layout. But we have shown the proposed locations at a few spots, and I'll point them out here. So to serve the 12-unit townhouse project, there's a proposed transformer at this location here, with a dedicated easement that's required by Reading Municipal Light. And then across the street, we're going to need a transformer, a dedicated transformer for each of the three buildings. And so we've identified areas that would line up with the grassy areas that are the islands associated with the potential future parking out of the front portion here, and then for the larger building, we've identified the location here. Reading Municipal Light, we've just recently sent them the expected loads, electric loads for the project, and they're going to be taking that information and doing a detailed design. But I at least was able to, on a preliminary basis, with Reading Light, at least get the approximate locations given where the existing utility poles are.
Chris, have you come up yet with where the transformer location would be for the large building in the back?
Yes, for the large building, we have a 6 by 8 pad at this location here. And that's all those locations are memorialized on the utility plan and the survey and layout plan. So that summarizes the changes to the site plan since the last time that we've seen it.
And that was basically just a couple of the, again, the pages in the original plan that you've given us, and you gave us another full set.
Yeah, we did a full set of drawings. The building footprints, of course, that Stephen Brickman described, all of that has been updated. So it's an updated complete plan set. The other thing that wasn't mentioned that I think is noteworthy is that None of the planting numbers, the amount of plantings we're proposing, trees, shrubs, perennials, none of those changed or reduced in number as a result of the increasing the footprints of these two buildings. We kept the numbers the same. And as Andrew read, Chuck's going to hit us up for some more trees. The area that he was talking about was between the retaining wall that's along this side of the project and our property line, where we're closest to Walker's Brook Canal.
What are the questions? No questions? No, official, sorry. Do we have an official adjustment or sign off on the motions? Can you say that again?
Has Nish, or Matt, has Matt and Nish reviewed these changes and given you any indication as to whether they're all okay or whether they've generated any further comments from him?
Sure, let me just grab, I have an email from Matt. So after our presentation back on the 12th, there were no additional outstanding items with regard to his review. The changes in the buildings that we sent along to him, his response to me was that he hasn't reviewed the specifics, but that relative to the scale of the project, it was an incidental change, in my opinion. That was in his words. And what he means by the details is that We even though each of the footprints changed approximately 724 square feet, we decided to run it through the model again just to see what the effects were going to be on the additional runoff that would result from that change in footprint. And they were very minor changes in the drainage report. We gave them a summary, but he hasn't had a chance to look at it. To put it in layman's terms, you remember we had a couple of underground stormwater management areas. So in that 100-year storm event, which is the theoretical 7-inch rainfall, the height of the water, the elevation of the water increases as a result of the footprint change by about three quarters of an inch. So it's not that much of a change, if you will. But he hasn't reviewed that summary table. No exceedances in peak flow or runoff. We're still mitigating everywhere. And that was the change in the water level in the underground stormwater structures, about 3/4 of an inch. Technically, it was 0.84, so a little bit more than 3/4 of an inch.
Thank you. Anybody from the community?
Just that last point there, what was the margin of, before? I mean, how much was there before in terms of margin to, overflow or whatever the negative consequence would be? How much did the 8.84 inches take away from that?
The answer to your question is that it doesn't affect the performance of the stormwater management system. We still have room, if you will, inside the chambers. If you recall, we do have snares where some of the piping in the network just upstream does surcharge loaded. We're talking about an additional 3/4 of an inch. So, in fact, a negligible impact. The specifics include a change in the overall peak flow, no change in overall peak flows except increases of 0.04 cubic feet per second in the 100-year storm event, at one of our comparison points that, as I mentioned before, still mitigates. In other words, we compare the existing peak flow at those locations to what it's going to be after we pull the water back and let it out slowly. And so we're still less than the existing condition at those comparison points. And again, the maximum increase in the water level was 0.07 feet, which when you calculate that out to inches, it's 0.84 inches.
Did I forget anything, Andrew? Anything else?
Can I just ask, if you remember that sight line along Lakeview with the fence, did you guys ever get confirmation about how that would be affected?
So I know that Mr. Manganiello did approach the folks at the Lakeview Apartments, and they agreed to allow us to remove one panel that would eliminate that problem.
We need a separate statement from the...
Yeah, if we could get something in writing, that would be very helpful.
Verify by the apartment. This then brings us to the draft decision.
Mr. Chair, sorry to interrupt. Before we leave the topic, I just wanted to clarify one point that Nick raised and Chris, Town Council, raised regarding the affordable unit counts, because I want to make sure that that's clear, that there's no change in the overall numbers. So on the original plan and in the new plan, in the townhouse lots, there's 12 townhouses, 3 affordable. In the original plan for the apartments, there were 34 one-bedrooms, 32 two-bedrooms, and 8 three-bedrooms. The 8 three-bedrooms don't change in any way on this plan. On the previous plan and on this plan, 2 of the 3 bedrooms were affordable. Now, on the previous plan, 8 of the 1 bedrooms were affordable. Now there's 6 1 bedrooms that are affordable. Previously there were 9 2 bedrooms that were affordable. That goes to 11. So that number 17 just changes around a little bit, stays the same. Just actually want to make that clear.
And I think that was addressed too in the first draft that we put together versus the last draft that was coming in.
So you said 2 of the 3 bedroom rentals are affordable?
Correct. Yeah. And that's all reflected in the current draft of the draft decision. The way it was originally written, all of the townhouse units and all of the apartment units were grouped together overall and in the affordable units. So when we did some proposed revisions, we suggested breaking those apart so that you break down the townhouses and the apartments.
So the board has a copy of that, which I really just want to see the first couple of pages of that basically involves the documents that came in and so forth. They're on page 8 of the updated draft. Is the findings followed by the waivers, the conditions prior to commencement of work, prior to issuance of the permits and the foundations of buildings, during construction, final occupancy permit documents, and the conditions for ongoing operation maintenance. So, there's a few, it boils down to just, I think, a few items in there that I think that may be in question. what I see as being somewhat necessary to discuss, I guess. The project overview, which is item number 10 on page 9. Previous sections, the project eligibility, the applicant, who the applicant is, the site, proposed project site, the zoning aspects of it, description, statutory minimum, certification of safe harbor, housing stock, public health, safety, and welfare, brings us down to 10, which is the project overview. One of the, and these are also then picked up in the waivers and so forth on down there too. So I'm just going to start with the project overview and go to the specific, which is the drawing, the interior space, the heights, the density, the parking, the traffic, the lighting, and so forth on down. If that's okay with the board? So the first issue that I would the first thing that I noticed comes down to a couple of things. One is the number of parking spaces, which involves the project, not the project, the pocket parking. Another comes down to right now, the applicant is asking for the pocket, which is the 10 bank spaces between the two smaller apartment structures. Usually I wait until the very end.
But
I just thought I'd throw it in here. The pocket design for the parking to me is great, but it's not realistic. Number of parking spaces, you did the project for the pocket parking, is an issue because you're not asking for waivers. And we have two distinct sections of this project. One is condos, which has 13 surface spaces, which meets the criteria for parking for condos, but also helps to diffuse the number of spaces needed in the lot B, or the second lot, which is 111. I'm thinking that it's much easier you showing 101 surface spaces right there, right now. The difference in that pocket design for now and the future, you're going to have to come in if that's needed. You're going to have to come in and have curb cuts. You're going to destroy, not destroy, you're going to modify it substantially. And I think, if I did my calculations right, the surface spaces gave us 2.08 spaces per unit in the condo section. And right now, on the 101, we come out with 1.36 parking spaces for Quad B. But the whole project, if you look at it, which is the 114, which is the 13 plus the 101, is out to be 114 over the 86 units. That comes out to be a difference of 1.33 units rounded off. It's 1.325 something, whatever. But it's roughly 1.33 units. I would prefer that we, since we're using this as a project, and it is important apparently to the neighborhood, but also to the town of Reading, for the board to consider reducing the 1.5 for the project, or in this particular situation, for the lot B to go down to the 1.36 for a total of 1.33 of the whole project, and not allow the parking, what you call the pocket parking, that is to remain there in so we're not going to touch that roof. We're sacrificing green. Okay.
You're talking Pixar.
Okay. Here's what I'm looking at. Right now, we're looking at the 1.5, so we don't have to issue a waiver on parking. Why not go to the 1.33, which represents the condo, which is not touched. It represents 1.36 on lot B. If we use the 101 surface spaces that is now on the control document that's been sent given to us this evening, that means we would have to give the applicant a waiver for the parking spaces, which is 0.17 if we're looking at the whole project. But we would not impact that area that we're saving for the future parking. That area is not to be touched. It no longer becomes a pocket parking section. It remains.
It remains
open and green.
So you're technically, in simple terms, saying to the board, let's reduce it to 1.36 or 1.33. Leave them. Never put any parking there. Don't give them, and give them a waiver.
Exactly.
Simple terms. Your numbers went so.
I'm just saying this to the board, more so than.
I just want to make clear that we're all working with the correct numbers. Okay. Because, so what we have for parking, we have 101 on the parking lot.
Correct.
If the parking park is not built, that's parking.
Correct.
We actually have 25 on the condo lot. So if you.
Yes, I know that.
Right. So if you add the two
but
together.
You're talking originally surface spaces. So if you add the 25 in, that brings up the number to 1.4.
I come up with 1.465, so just under the 1.5 ratio. Right. So the waiver.
But here's the question. I know that. Here's the question that I had, though. If we're looking at two entities, we're looking at the condo as one part of the project, but once that is occupancy permit been granted to the 12 units, it no longer is part of the project. You can't go over there and park on the, in those spaces. So in reality, we're talking about the project as a whole, but we're still coming back to two entities within the project. And to make it very simple, the surface area is what you were looking at, the surface spaces that you marked out on the original plan, the 13 and the 101. I didn't include the 12 that are underneath or part of the actual, because when those are sold off, we can't include them in the overall project. And,
so Mr. Chair, I mean, the team would like to have the right to be able to build a ratio of parking spaces that's equal to 1.5 on the apartment project. The only way we can do that is if
not if the board gives you a waiver.
Right, we don't want the waiver. We want you to have the ability to have to build those parking spaces if the need arises in the future.
I know that.
It might happen.
I know that. But for the difference, if you want to include that to the whole project, we're giving you a waiver of 0.04 if you include the 25 spaces on the on lot A and lot B. So what you're increasing is 0.04 to the 1.5 needed. And for that, I don't, in my mind, if I lived there, I wouldn't want to take that additional. You have very little green space on that particular section. You've got the green space on lot A. You don't have virtually any green space on lot B. And for the 74 people going to occupy lot B, I think it's, in my mind, this is, and I'm asking the board what their thoughts are first, and then I want to hear from everybody else. But I mean, this is just a thought that's been rolling around in my head for a while.
And to John, go ahead, son. I was comfortable with what was proposed, the 101 spots for the apartments, the 10 banked, and I think the townhouses are fine with the, you know, it's basically an average of, 1.5 per, 2.08, yeah, it's more than 2 per unit there, 25 to 12 pound
units.
So I said, you set that aside, that's fine, that's taken care of, don't even think of it about that.
Exactly.
Go to the apartments, and you have 101 spaces for 74 units, and that comes out to the 1.15, was it?
No, 1.36.
Okay, so it was fine. And I think we've gone over this, and I had no problems with the banking, which provides them with more green space there. Obviously, that's there for the hand, for the future, if needed, that they could use that. Okay. I was comfortable with that myself. Si, go ahead.
Well, one thing I do agree with you on, I would love to keep that space green.
Yes.
Okay, and not face down the road, changing that to parking. And I'd love to find a way to keep it green. Now, for projects like this, what I've seen, I love the projects of this size, parking ratios of the order of 1.36, I would consider it to be on the high side. But down in the 1.25, even less than that, is not uncharacteristic of projects, in my view, of this size. So I would say, I'd love to see that kept green, not to change anything but green, but find a way, even if you reduce the parking ratio. I haven't bothered this one at all, to reduce it a little to be able to compensate for that of space there. Okay. I don't have a problem with that. I'd love to see that space here. I know, Chris, you mentioned you'd like to keep it.
I'll have the ability to take or
have
that ability
to do it.
If
you
need
to, I don't think it's necessary.
We've already done that on another project. Reduced it from 1.5.
We've been done 1.25. I mean, we've been down to 1.25. Yeah.
Yes.
And
this has actually a much better layout than the 1.25 that we went to.
Yes,
and has the ability for the extra.
Now, I think as the plans are submitted with the green space there for that area that's supposed to be for the 10 bank spaces. I think that's future, and I have to count it as green space right now, and if it's ever used in the future, I really don't care whether it's what the ratio is, 1.5, 1.8, 1.2, you need 10 extra spaces, there it is. And if what you're getting at is that the ratio is going to be below 1.5, the 101 spaces is what they're asking for. And I think that's going to require a waiver request. So they do it. That's what it is. Yeah. I would love to see that kept as green space there. Okay. Yeah. Absolutely.
I would also like to see that have green space. I don't see the parking utilization creeping to 1.5. And if it did, I'd rather see a parking management plan mitigate that for touching the green space. I think there's very little green space, and
changes are coming up again. I'm sure that there's, probably a sentiment on their end that the rug is getting pulled out from under them, that things are starting to untangle. So if there's a way that you can preserve that, I think it's great. Well, the neighborhood has already they've taken enormous pains over the last year to really invest in this project and make some tremendous suggestions. This is a way to lock that in. I think that I think also it's a good idea just for the town as well, not just for them. I think it's a good project. It has like almost like a college quad feel to it, which I think is a good residential bucolic feel to it. I think more parking.
I would ask Jesse just one question. We call it the quad area then? That quad area, went with that. That's not going to affect, I don't think it will affect the parking, the financial aspects of the unit, if anything. It would increase the saleability of, or the marketability of that.
Well, that's a tough question. And I think that's why the pocket park idea that was proposed by the neighborhood, I think that's why that is a really smart solution to the problem, because frankly, there's a lot of variables involved with it. I think there's a lot of trends going on now with, there's data that suggests that young people aren't buying cars, aren't using cars quite as much as they are. However, there's other information out there suggesting that people are starting to abandon public transport in favor of autonomous cars, and that's something maybe that's going to be happening. And so the flexibility to go to the parking, if it proves to be necessary, is a smart solution. But let's be clear, we're in agreement with the unanimous board and with the neighborhood. We like the pocket park too. It helps our project as well. We want it green if it can be green. However, if it's needed, if there's too many cars on a lot and it's spilling out into the street, that's, the neighbors aren't going to like that. If the units aren't moving because the residents want to be able to park two cars and there aren't enough spaces, that's something that possibly could happen. But barring those kind of variables coming up, we don't plan to pave that over. But think about it. If we're in the position where we're paving that over, Guy has already paid to develop it as green space, leave it that way, and now he's paying again to tear out everything he's installed and then put down pavement. It doesn't look nicer for the neighborhood or for the site. And so our commitment is we'll keep it if it's possible. And what we would like to do and what we propose in the language for the draft decision is to have a procedure where we would come to the board and say, it's necessary, here's why, and get your sign off.
Are you speaking for the neighborhood?
I speak for myself. Yeah, this is like important. I think we got together, we wanted to do the part, we did research, we tried to make the case. They met us halfway, they are very kind of open to it, and we do understand the desire to have sufficient parking, and we are. I personally am comfortable. I think they're professional. They're not going to just make it a last and just without real need. I would like, however, to understand better the procedure that would trigger it, and I don't know how much detail is in the language, so I'm just not sure how that would burden, or the, they just have such an avenue and then the board will decide, like, is it more like, is it?
I can speak to that briefly because the condition on this has gone through a couple of different drafts in the past 2 weeks. Originally, myself and staff produced the first draft decision. That I think what the first draft provided for was that it'll start as a pocket park. It could potentially one day be converted to parking, but if they ever wanted to convert it to parking, they would have to submit a parking utility. They'd have to wait for at least a year after full occupancy or 80% occupancy to go that whole lot, and then submit a parking utilization study that demonstrated that they well and truly needed those missing 10 to community development tax. In the first draft, that we would have kept that away from the board, that would have been a staff level. In the second draft, which was produced by the applicant, they wanted some additional flexibility built into that process and wanted not necessarily have to wait that long. And wanted, I think the main difference between our respective positions there was that they wanted the ability to convert those 10 spaces if it was needed for reasons of marketability, which I think is a broad term that could include a wide range of rationales on their part. So we pushed back into what became the third draft and most recent draft. We pushed back a little bit on that and said that they would need to submit the request to staff and support it in some way, and didn't really, in this new draft, try to pin down precisely what it was that they would need to show staff, because we figured by this point we were going to be talking about it tonight, the whole board would have an ability to be in. So none of, I don't think myself or staff were necessarily wedded to what we put in the first draft, but we wanted to have some level of proof, at least, that the applicant would need to show somebody to justify the conversion of those spaces. The board can, but again, that's just our first draft. Teeing the discussion up to the board is, I think, in the end, up to the board, whether it wants to keep this part forever, allow conversion at some future date, and if it wants to allow conversion at some future date, what it is they want to see from the applicant to support that conversion, and who it wants to have analyze that. The only other thing is that if, theoretically, if the decision were not to, were to say, leave it as a park forever, period, the applicant could still come up a year from now and ask you to modify that part of its decision. Because there's nothing that's gonna, the board can emphasize the importance of the park to varying degrees in its decision, but nothing would ever prevent the applicant from coming back and asking permission to do something a year or two down the road.
Maybe just follow up. So there's like this huge parking space there.
There's a provision under in our zoning bylaw that allows for shared parking in a couple of different ways, so that new developments can meet the parking requirements by exercising that option of shared parking. So that's in the zoning bylaw. When we look at many of the sites from a site planning point of view, we often get into a conversation about shared parking. It's that typical scenario where you have users that need parking at different times. This comes up a lot, for example, in the downtown area, where you could have a restaurant and a bank. The bank's active during the day, the restaurant's active at night, so that's a natural way to do shared parking. If you're referring to the adjacent residential multifamily Lakeview apartments, I think early on we began to talk about ways to make these two projects work together from the very early stages of meetings. And I don't know how tricky that is. You know, from a planning point of view, we think it's a great idea, but I'm not sure how easy it is to execute.
Yeah, I don't know the logistics, but it just seems it's already built.
Yeah, I agree.
Yes. David Cannon, 30 Beach Street. So, in regards to Oriana's point, would the developer, if parking needed to be increased in the future, be willing to reach out to Lakeview Apartments to make an agreement to share some of their lot instead of going to the Boston Park first, you know, as a first resort. Any thoughts?
I'm not, I don't want to say we're not willing to reach out to them, but that's the kind of arrangement that seems like has a lot of variables. So I don't think we would be comfortable having a condition of that sort.
Not a condition, but just hypothetical.
If it's short, if they would be willing to do something like that. But if you think about it from a liability standpoint, if it were your home and I said, can I use one of your driveway spots, and one of my tenants parked in your driveway, slipped on ice, hurt themselves, you're not liable. So it gets really tricky. That's a very baseline example of that. Sign an agreement that you're liable if any of your tenants slip on my property. Now I have to worry that he's not cleaning or is maintaining his grounds to the point where there isn't a title to my tenants.
Right.
It's pretty convoluted. Not that it isn't here, right here. In a perfect world with anybody acting in neighborly way, that would be an issue.
Just to follow up on. We've actually pursued this more recently over the summer and into the fall when we did an updated parking study of the downtown. So we have model documents on the website for how you could do shared parking and how other communities have done it.
How does it speak to liability?
Well, what's the model that we're most familiar with is where, for example, in the downtown, the town could be the leaseholder of the shared parking spaces and then sublease it to the entity that is trying to use those spaces. Because as the town, and I'm not the lawyer, but it pulls your argument out. There's no potential for
obviously.
And I'll let the lawyer explain the legalese on that, but it removes that problem.
I'd have to think. It does, but I can't.
But it's a model that's been used in other places.
Clearly, it's common to the point.
Well, it's as I said, there's a lot of moving parts to it. It can be done, and there are models out there where it is done, but.
Vehicles that are registered to park in our spots, and at that point I think we would bring it to the attention of the board and say, hey, listen, we've got 2 units still available and we're at capacity for parking. We can't market these units without parking, and I think that would be the triggering point. I think it's a fair and honest approach to it.
Well, I think that raises absolutely. I think with other 4D projects, we've been a little bit, perhaps, more demanding of a parking management plan. It will require the applicant to manage the spaces more carefully so that you don't get to the point where you've got 2 units left when you're out of spaces. In other words, and that doesn't exist in the current draft decision, but it's certainly something we're thinking about dealing with. In other words, there's been a representation from the applicant that give us 101 spaces in the park, and that should be good enough for a good long while. I mean, I think that's fair. So maybe
we need to talk more about what we need to do to ensure that 101 faces is good enough for a while, so that we're not back here, and that can be a manager plan that you guys think about and show to
us. The other side is we just go up the spots and go by the town bylaw. You don't have to worry about marking our units at any point.
The flip side of that point is that then the board starts focusing more on the absence of open space and says, no, you can't do that. You got to go back and redo your plans and find the green space. Because that's how you're showing, that's how you're running it now. So I think the board, as the application has been presented, it's fair for the board to believe that 101 spaces should be sufficient, and that you want to be able to manage the project well enough that 101 spaces will do.
We hope so. I mean, that's the goal, right? But at the end of the day, you have to worry about submitting an investment. And have another investment.
However, the last portion of your initial comment, Chris, was that down the line, should, after the proper management, because I've seen that happen in other entities, if that should happen, the applicant, still has the right to come back and petition staff in the town through a number of alternative pathways to ask for a modification. If the board says that remains as green space. So that the 101 on the surface area for lot B should be sufficient. I mean, you're not, as Chris said, you're not shut off from utilizing that in the future. And right now,
they're not shut off from asking you for permission to use it. The only question is how much flexibility the board wants to build in for the applicant's benefit at this stage of the process.
Exactly, but the other point that you just raised now, I think is the critical portion, and that's the management aspect of the 101 spaces, which is at 1.36 that you're using right now. I mean, it's hard to say 0.36 of a park space or a vehicle or a person who's living in one of those units, but the aspect of it is that Reading is losing green space upon green space in our 40Bs. We can't continue to do this and make it a livable area within the community. Otherwise, what you're trying to create starts to fall apart down the road, which is not good for you, and it's not good for the town of Reading, nor is it good for the neighborhood.
Just to be clear, we will have a parking management plan that will handle parking throughout the site. The reason why we suggested the change in the first draft of language, which talked about age is not the same as a study, is it limits our ability to respond in a way that a parking management plan can't really respond if you simply don't have the physical space for all the cars, and in a way that a parking management plan doesn't speak to the marketability. A parking management plan has something to say about marketability of units. If you've got the 2, 3, 4, 5 years down the line, finds that the units aren't renting. So what we proposed was the mechanism is in place where we would come back to the board to clear with you that here's what we want to do and here's why, here are the reasons, but to eliminate the very formalistic procedure where we're waiting to 80% and then a study for a year and then coming back. Because if you do that, then you potentially have a year where you're studying it, and I could tell you by driving by that we don't have enough parking because every single spot is full. So it's more to give us the flexibility to respond to the needs of the residents of this new development, as well as the neighborhood who aren't going to like it if the lot is full and cars are suddenly parking up and down even like you. So I think the language that we proposed, and Chris had some changes back to it, and we're in agreement with the lanes that you propose. We think it's a good middle ground. Gives you control, gives us flexibility.
Go ahead.
Yeah, Matt Holman, 11 Beach Street. I just had a question. In that parking management plan, or on that block, are the spaces going to be numbered and assigned to the units, or is it a free-for-all?
I don't think there's a plan right now to assign spaces. It'll free-for-all, as you say. Okay. Some of them are designated as handicapped accessible, obviously.
Okay.
And then there will be a few spaces, I believe, on the right side of the parking lot, where some of the spaces can be designated for loading, if there's a need for a second loading zone. But other than that, it's residents, guests, all parking over time.
Okay, would having numbered spaces with, you know, assigned to units, you know, be something to consider?
So you can do it two ways. Mm-hmm. You can do it free-for-all the number way. And each one has its positive and negative.
Okay.
The free-for-all, obviously, everyone's scrambling for the spot right next to the building, and you get those little tussles about that. And I don't want to park all the way down the end, and blah, blah, blah. But on the number side, you also get a problem, too, because inevitably somebody is going to park in the wrong spot. And then it becomes a management problem. That they have to track the person down, they have someone complaining all the time. And it's an ongoing thing. And I've seen it both ways with different types of developments we've developed and designed for, and the owners that way. So doing it, you know, there's no right answer to that. It depends on how much management time you want to spend, you know, on one end or the other. But I think you can flex between them too. So, you know, if it starts off with a free fall and it's not working, then they might try numbered and see if that works better. And that might work better. It all depends on the tenants too, some depending on who they are and stuff. So the answer is yes, they can do it both ways. I think starting, you know, he's chosen a way that I think is a little bit less onerous on him on the management side. But we'll see how it, you know, I think they'll see how it happens as they go along, you know, for that.
Can I just do a follow-up too? Way back when this project was first started, or at least I first became aware of it, I looked at, you know, who owned a lot of this land, just kind of being, does your company own, or organization, or whatever you want to call yourselves, own more land along Lakeview and Eaton? For some reason I thought that when I looked at zoning first, or who actually owns the land, if you did, could you have overflow parking on one of those other other pieces of parcels at some point? Or is that something that's going to be a phase two of this project someday?
At this time, other than my own home building.
Okay.
Can I just make a comment on the parking? So I've been told, like, often people create an incentive, like monetary incentive, to control parking. So for example, you get one car per unit for free, and you have to pay a small fee for a second car, and that kind of, I don't know, motivates people the way you want it to want to see it. So have you considered something along those lines?
I don't know that we specifically considered that idea. I know what you're talking about in terms of incentivizing not having parking spaces, parking demand, essentially. It's all things to consider, and I think it's all things to consider as the parking lot starts to fill up. You know, it really depends on who's occupying these units, I think, to a certain extent. And frankly, in most of the applications that we have for projects like this, we're arguing the other way, that we need less parking, not more. So it's tough to say whether that would work, whether based on who's renting these apartments. Maybe you get somebody who's downsizing from somewhere bigger in Linfield, and they've got two big Cadillacs like Ted has, and they don't want to get rid of them. So we just don't know. And there's really no way of knowing. So that's why I think the flexibility solution is the way to go.
You also can affect yourself at a competitive disadvantage.
Yeah,
but there are other facilities that offer parking for free. I have a like for like unit, and I'm charging for parking for a second vehicle. So I get what you're saying, but it's not a bad idea. And it's, we do that at some of the properties that we own in the city, but it's all.
I've been involved fault if another unit not being ran for many years. The ratio was 1.5 for the difference between the 1.5 and 1.36 is minuscule when we're really talking about it. The idea is if it's a condo or condo facility, and the issue is the management aspect of it. You're going to be on site in terms of management. You can create whatever is the rules and regulations that people want to live in this particular facility. The nice thing about this facility is it's going to be a first-class, as I understand it, facility. You can walk very easily to the train. You can walk across the street for anything from food to clothing. You can walk around the corner for repairs to virtually anything. You can walk by furniture out your back door. What more do you need type of thing? But the aspect of it is, the 1.36 and the 1.50 is minuscule. And if you have the opportunity to say, hey, you got the 1.5, I can tell you the 1.5 is not going to save you if you have a free-for-all in parking. When you create it and you start leasing, you're going to have to create it if it was a condo facility, and these are the rules and regulations, period. To save the pocket park, I'm still of the opinion that we need to do that, but I'm only one person. So right now, I want to go to the rest of the board to see where the board stands.
Have you, of all the parking spaces, you're kind of saying leave wide open, free for all the parking, okay? Have you considered the fact that maybe the 74 tenants that would exist in that facility, and that might be, that maybe they should have 74 assigned spaces and leave the rest of them free for all? These people who live there have an assigned space. That's another thing.
That's applied, but it still lends itself to the fact that somebody could be parking in somebody else's spot even accidentally.
No, that's true.
Let's say, for instance, a nurse that works
in somebody's going to set them straight if they find something to
do. Right, but then they decide to all of your tenants in our time.
And also, the fact is, maybe one tenant has two cars, too. I mean, I understand that, too. Okay? One has a space to park in, the other one has a compass.
But that's the management aspect.
That's the management aspect.
That's the management aspect.
That's exactly right. But I don't think I've been in a facility like this where I have not seen assigned spaces. Maybe I haven't seen that many. Okay,
I've seen many apartment buildings. At Lakeview, I don't think it's assigned spaces for all residents.
Really?
No.
Do you know that?
No.
No.
Next
they
door.
They have lots of bicycles, though.
Yeah. Many apartment complexes don't have assigned spaces.
No. You don't have to have assigned spaces.
No.
You just have to be guaranteed of one space.
Yeah.
After that, is the management aspect of it. And how you manage your own facility is up to you.
Just to be clear, what we're talking about, are you suggesting a condition where the parking spaces be numbered by residents?
I don't think that the board, believe me, I'm not proposing that.
No.
All I'm proposing is that you have, because addressed at the very back of this is one of the things that you're going to give us, is the management plan, which is more than just parking. And we don't have that yet. So not seeing that, it's very difficult to address it. But you're not new to this. You come up with something, at least in my mind, you come up with something, and you won't impact the pocket park. Wow, what's your feeling?
My feeling is we should, I agree with you, John. I would like to keep that green space there, that quad, that space between the two smaller buildings. Yes, free, green. And I think that's what they've established. We're going to do it. And if they decided as property owners, it's their property, and they say, geez, you know, we're overflowing here. We want to pave that and put parking in there. And they have to come back to the town to do that. And that's the condition you put in there, period. Now, whether they have to come back to the board, I don't
town planning office, period. And if they work it out with the town planner.
Or CPDC.
Or CPDC, right.
Some other form of staff. At least,
but no, I agree. I like the green park in there, and I think that's what they've established that it's going to be in there. But again, whether they put in there that, you know, we're going to bank this for the future for 10 spaces, or they don't say that, obviously we all know it could be used for 10 spaces. Whether they say it or they don't, it could be, and they could come back to the town in 10 years and say we need it.
It would be nice if they built it like a park, because the super is not designed for a park, so I don't want it to be just a park, complete park, and just left alone for paving. So I would really love to see some really real investment into it. I mean, I understand why they want to be cautious, but that's okay. But it would be nice to be targeted.
Turns out somewhere down the road, a need presents itself. Right now, there is no need. The need presents itself down the road, which I quite frankly don't think it's not going to happen. Then I think the town would be receptive to
I think
the suggestion. I don't even think this board would be receptive.
It is. I hate this sitting on the board and speculating what's going to happen in the future when nobody knows. You can't call the future. You can make provisions, and I think that's what they've done. Period. Leave it at that.
And I, same sentiments as the board has already said. I echo them. I think the need for that green space trumps the parking. I think 1.36 is acceptable, and I think you can work within it. I don't want to tell you that the stickers in the cars, the sign spaces, whatever that is, I think you can provide your own relief in your own. You're on a good point. I also don't want to see that space just left flat, vacant, with the, you know, with the thought that you might develop it into parking. I'd like to see it utilized into, you know, an amenity, some type of green space that doesn't have a, you know, in the back of your head that this is just a placeholder. It should be green space, it should be utilized, and there was thought that there was a type of rain darling, some type of landscaping, and then it looks permanent, not semi-permanent. It should be like an investment in that green space. That is the only green space for all those units. That's all that.
Actually, it would behoove you as the applicant or as the owner to make that as much of a park as possible, because that's going to attract the people to come and rent and lease.
Just again, we agree 100%. The bulldozer is not on Lakeview Avenue. We plan on building it as a park. It'll be landscaped. It'll be amenities for the residents. We want the park, unless it's absolutely necessary not to have a park. We agree with the neighbors. We agree with the board. There will be a park in perpetuity unless it becomes necessary not to.
I think down the road, the need to arise, we thought you needed to do that. I think the biggest obstacle would be the tenants.
Yeah, that's true too. And frankly, the neighborhood.
The biggest obstacle, because you don't want what they have, and you're not going to see them.
Yeah.
Well, everyone in the room knows I like the quad. So, I also, excuse me, I do like what Chris is doing, building in some sort of mechanism and some sort of, some degree of quantifiable meaning. That you actually have to wait and see, and I know you're not suggesting that the bulldozers are there, but I mean, I'd like to have something written in that it can't come down the street. You know, just some sort of provision that, you know, when you do come before a decision-making entity, whether that's the board, town staff, or whatever it ends up being, I mean, totally fine with whoever's receive control over for that decision. But I do think that, you know, you should have some, like I said, some quantifiable grounds to say, okay, we looked at it, this is what we thought, coming back, this is what justifies the change. Because I do think that it's a nice feature for the development. Obviously, I just mentioned that the neighborhood likes it, but also think it's good for the town, which is really what the board is charged with. It's up.
So just to be clear, that as the draft decision is currently drafted with Chris's proposed changes of language, it reads that the applicant, if and when the applicant determines that the land bank parking spaces are needed, parentheses, due to parking need, project marketability, et cetera, the applicant shall notify the planning department of such in writing and provide supporting documentation demonstrating the need for conversion of the land bank spaces to actual parking. Approval by the planning department of this work shall not be unreasonably withheld, and we propose an addition there for delay. So there is a procedure, there is a requirement for documentation, it would be in writing. If the board is inclined to make this a sort of procedure where it comes before the actual zoning board, that would be a different question. It would be maybe something in the vein of a minor modification to a special permit, that sort of thing. Planning staff, I think, is more than competent to work with us to determine that. So there is a procedure built in, even with the modified language.
That's true. Although I think that's a revision that you made to what Chris had originally proposed, which is a little, I think you're trying to just pull back on what I understand the person sent out earlier with these stringent provisions.
It's gone both ways, actually. So we pulled back, and Chris pushed back ably from his end. So it's gone both directions.
So, yes. So just to be, and again, I'm not putting any draft language together. I guess really where I stand on that spectrum is I think I would like to see it be a little more stringent. I don't know if you would agree with me. Of course, leave that to Chris's capable hands to work out with you. I think that planning staff is, in my opinion, perfectly capable of handling that. And I don't think that you can come back to this board for that. Like I said, I think that maybe a more rigorous, clearer, more quantifiable, particularly with time standards, because I know you want the flexibility if you had to do it next month. I want like a year to go by where at least you can see how the park is there. I just build a case to say, okay, yeah, we can. That's just my.
Now, I have a question. Just as one board member, I don't even know if I want any verbiage of land banking even in the draft. And I also question if this were to be paved over, and this may be a question for Chris, would that be a substantial change to the project if this was not even mentioned in the draft and then they came back and wanted to park?
I think based upon what I'm hearing from most of the board is that the board wants to see this kept as a park, and it wants to see it kept as a park because that's the open space, open green space being provided as part of the project, and that what the board would think of as the necessary amount of open green space can't possibly exist anywhere else on the site. So I think if we write the decision in a way that emphasizes the importance of this as a park, and they were to come back in a year and want to convert it to parking spaces, and the decision didn't otherwise say that that was okay. All it says is this is a park, and it's going to be a park, and that provides the necessary open space, and they want to convert it later, I think there would be good grounds to argue that that would be a substantial change for the project.
And that would,
because it's not just adding in more parking spaces, it's adding in more parking spaces and subtracting a really important component of the project. So would the Housing Appeals Committee find that to be a substantial change? If that would take a lot of appeal, I can't say. But I think that would be a defensible ground for the board to find that to be substantial. But just to say you wouldn't still have to grant it later on, just would get you over that first
hurdle. But
that would require, I think if that approach would require, or I think you would want to revise the decision to sort of scrub out the idea that this might be converted, because the
down to this important reason.
And that would potentially give the residents the ability to have a comment as well.
As the condition currently exists in the decision, I'm hearing that that might change very quickly. There would be no, it would just happen automatically at the staff level, or not. They would, that decision would be vested in them, and there wouldn't be much more.
So is it possible to have the board discuss
the approach that I was just talking about, which is to say it should stay as a park. And then if they wanted to change it later on, that would come back in front of the board. And there would be a meeting of the board to determine whether that was a substantial change or an insubstantial change. And there would not, that would happen quickly, and there wouldn't necessarily be public notice in the mail to all of the abutters, but there would at least be a posted agenda, and that would
be posted. Yeah.
And then if it was a substantial change, then the board would still have to decide whether to grant it or not, but that would require a public hearing with notice to everybody.
Including the residents. Both the name board as well as the people.
So my question, I was kind of curious about what Jesse read out as it was read out. I'll not ask the question if it's already decided that the language is going to change on this stipulation.
The language would change. I mean, section E on page 10 of the draft decision would exclude the 111 in the calculation and put in the 1.5. It would also appear the waiver doesn't have it.
It just kind of sounded like you were saying that they apply, approval will not be withheld.
That language was included in the draft for purposes of discussion with the party board. That was not intended to be any final condition.
None of this is in cement.
No, I know. I was just trying to, so it's a lot of legal, you know, you talk, you know, whatever, and I was trying to do the layman's, like, all right, what did that actually say from a, you know, who does what, and
that would
is
be,
there actually a decision?
Yeah, that would be a staff-level decision, as Jesse would.
Okay, so we
seem to
be all
over
the
place.
I think so.
I like what Nick said, that I don't think there's any need to be talking about land bank green space. Leave it at that. We don't even have to get into if that was parking, it would be 1.5. We don't even need that.
3.6.
We could pick out one whole sentence in that decision here. Anything referring to.
Well, when they're redoing the draft, they would have to pick that up in a couple of different sections of
right.
That.
Right. Yeah.
Okay. Moving on. The next section is section F on page 10, which is the logging. I want to see where we stand on that. There's two proposed changes. One, there is a change on the control document that was submitted on the 22nd, which shows one curb and one down by the dumpster area on the northeast side.
Southwest corner.
And the other one is the full parking spaces on the northerly side of the, right there. And that would be used by the management, that the owners of the project, if they decide, but only during daylight hours and posted ahead of time so people are know that. And that would have to be in the management aspect that you're still to give to the board and approved by staff. I mean, the board's not going to do all that stuff. Okay. So how does the board feel about the two parking spaces that are on the new control document?
I don't have a problem with it.
I don't mean that. I'm fine with it. Yeah.
Nick?
Yeah.
Eric?
It's good for me.
Okay. Next we come to G. On to the next page. Traffic, which is the other alpha. Okay. There are we have one of the I'm taking this right now because it appears in a number of places in the community draft decision. But we also had a proposal for the Walker's Brook corridor review, which we have a bid back on, or Green got back to us and gave us the, their proposal on what needs to be done. We have a revision on that this evening. The board just got it. There is a figure on that. I don't know if anybody has done an opportunity to see that. That was for the entire project proposal. Did we have a time? I didn't get to read that myself. Did we get a time limit on that? Yeah, projected time.
I don't think so.
An interest in putting some money towards that. That is, to me, as one member of the board, substantial and distinct from the traffic aspect of the existing site right now coming out on Walker's Brook Road. And there were, Green suggested three options. The police came up with a proposal on just one of them as being the opportune of the three suggestions that were made, and that was degree of signaling. I don't know how to address that at this point. I have my own feelings on it. I would like to hear the board's feelings on it. Others tend to say, I believe that there has to be some mitigation on that immediately without the Walker's Brook Drive study, only because you have basically two ways in and out. One is off of Salem Street, and that means your heavy trucking for the duration of the project is going to be either off of Eaton Street, or it's going to be off of Lakeview. And Lakeview is going to be torn up one way or the other. But having big equipment and stuff going in there during the construction period, we're just asking for, in my mind, you talk about litigation, I talk about litigation for the town. You can't have no litigation on that coming on the Walker's Brook Road. It needs to be addressed. So what do we do? I'm asking the question as one board member, but I want to hear what the other board members have. Since we're going through this draft proposal, I want to see where everybody comes in. I know that the neighborhood would prefer no mitigation at all. The police department is proposing the easiest one is the signal, although it is expensive, and how we deal with that. And the third and other options, I don't know if are viable or not, but I do have to hear from the board members. Anybody want to chime in?
Yeah, the concern I have is that I went all the way over to page 16. That's right. says it's going to address Walker Brookworks and John attached to the corridors, the funds of which shall be provided prior to the issuance of a building permit. And it is anticipated that the analysis will be completed prior to the issuance of a final certificate of occupancy. That's way ahead down the road. Okay? And it also goes on to say that in the event that no such study has been conducted by the town within 5 years, which suggests you may never do the study, okay, then, you know, where are we? I think it needs to be focused on some more detail. Right now, it's very open. But the concern with people, one of the biggest things on the start of this hearing was traffic. And now it's migrating down the road. We don't even talk about, haven't talked about it anymore, and it could conceivably end up doing nothing the way it's drafted right now. And I just find that unacceptable. I'm not sure how we reword it at this point. But I think we've got to do something. It needs to be some specific details. We can't make decisions without some kind of study. Well, certainly it shouldn't have that correct.
Well, it would seem we need some kind of mitigation in Walker's Brook Drive. I don't know what it would be, to be honest with you. I'm not a traffic engineer. That's what we're hiring somebody for, to give the town recommendations. I don't think they would be involved with the developer. They would be contributing to that study. Personally, I would tend to go with the, I would be more with the police position. I've always thought that signals could be incorporated in there. There's already signals in the proximity, close proximity, and I thought it would all be tied together. I think that's to need a traffic study for to see if it can be done and how well it could be done. But that's what I would wait for, is the traffic study, and I think that's what the town is proposing here. And I think that, you know, even though the draft says the town doesn't do anything in 5 years, I don't know if that's going to happen or not. But I think, you know, that's what we should do, is just, you know, go with the recommendations and let the town engineer, the planning department, make a decision on what improvements are going to be done on that. That's my idea, yeah.
So, to me, the traffic issue has exists now and will exist with or without this project. I think this project has become a lightning rod for the community to voice its concerns with the traffic. I totally understand that. I'm not a subject matter expert, and this does take time. It's going to go out, it's going to get procured, the study has to happen. I personally think anything we try to do now, it may work, it may not work. We don't really know outside of this study. It's a pretty expensive study, but the cost estimate. I think the mitigation here is really the applicant willing, and I think it's great that we contribute funding to support this traffic study. See what the best solution is. So I'm more of a wait and see what this traffic study has to say. Only because my concern is either I don't want to see, you know, just trying to be impulsive and throw money at something that may or may not work. Just because I've heard so many different ideas, and that's great, but it also scares me a little bit because there's a lot of ideas out there. So I'm more of a wait and see.
I'm with Nick on this. I think that you need to make the right decision, because if it ends up being, if you're picking between A, B, and C, if you pick A and C ends up being best, all the money that you spend to do A, the signal just goes out the window and everyone's going to be upset about it.
Right.
That's just my 2 cents.
Okay. There's one more person that I think we ought to hear from.
Well,
Well, you're higher up on the ladder. I go to Andrew, but
I am sympathetic to the board members who have said they're concerned about what happens in the short term while we're trying to take a comprehensive view of this. I'm sympathetic to that. At the same time, being a planner, and I think staff has said this in the past, I want to be making decisions and supporting decisions that work for the neighborhood. And the neighborhood has been vocal in saying they prefer a more macro level approach. And so, you know, the neighbors are the ones that are going to have to live with this. And I think that their voice has been part of this process all along.
So your recommendation would be to do nothing for the present. Wait until the study has been concluded, whatever that may be,
yeah.
And go from there.
Yeah. I would say work with the neighbors.
You can't come back to them. Don't come back in the middle of the project.
Can I say something?
No. Go ahead.
So for me, has been the conclusion, so we started, we looked, and we thought that that's so terrible. So we did, me and Mike, all this research, and the Department of Transportation made the graphs, like area which is on the state list, and this and this. So we learned a lot, and we were kind of surprised, and thought, oh, that's, we looked at property, but something complicated to fix it, maybe consider adding a new lane to connect Market Basket to the other road. I'm not saying it's easy, and I understand town meeting has to step in, but we need to, there may be a simple solution, which is not fixed intersection, maybe it's just evaluate if it's feasible to have another exit from Market Basket to a different road, and maybe that would solve it for everybody. And I know we raised it as an issue, but I do feel that this development is not really the core problem here. I do feel that this was pre-existing, and the more the town developed this area, with more businesses and more people out of town coming, so it's kind of, they've been very collaborative so far, so I do feel that it's not even fair to them to be held responsible for something that maybe the solution is different. And then I don't know how this traffic study is done, but I hope there'll be a way, a forum for the public to make suggestions and participate. I just do hope that here. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Okay. Can I follow along with that? I mean, one question I have about the traffic study is, what is this? I didn't see it, so I don't read the scope. What is the length of Walker's Brook that it is studying? Does it start at the highway and go to John Street? Does it go further than John? Like, what is the distance that it's covering? And does it cover like New Crossing Road and?
Yes. So we covered the John Street at a few intersections, key intersections, Salem Street, Pleasant Street, and we moved down Walker's Brook Drive. A few of the intersections have already been studied by Green International from this project, but we're talking Lakeview at Walker's Brook, General Way at Walker's Brook, Washington at Main, Washington at Walker's Brook.
All the way down to Washington.
All the way down to Washington.
Yeah, and then even including Ash Street and Main Street connection. So we have quite a bit of study going on.
Okay. So we have recommendations now. The last person. Jesse, you want to take this up?
Sure. So everyone can summarize how we got here. Basically, the neighborhood has expressed pretty decisively, I would say, that they don't want another Band-Aid measure. If you're looking at the context of just this project, the simplest solution is just to slap a no left turn sign on there and move on to the next project, but the neighborhood doesn't want that. So the idea, that's how the idea came about of the traffic study, that we're willing, we're agreeable to making a contribution on the order of something like a Band-Aid measure to avoid having to make a Band-Aid measure, because the problem, as Boriana noted and as Nick noted, the problem is existing and it will be there whatever happens with this property. We add to it a small amount and we're willing to contribute proportionally to that. That's our position. And so when the idea got more concrete of doing something like a traffic study, we communicated with Gene and with Julie and Andrew, and they worked with Green International to put this together. And they were open to our comments, but basically what they said was, this is for the town's need, generally and in a broad sense. So we really didn't have much to say in terms of the scope of the agreement, or sorry, the scope of the study, because this is the town's broader study. This is not having to do with this. So what you see, if you read the scope, it's very broad. It goes down to Lake Quanpahuit, it goes down to Ash Street, it talks about multimodal transportation, issues that really go way, way beyond what our project is. We didn't have any problem with that, though, because this is the town's need, again. So what we did, once we have the scope, we asked Kim, and he's here, and I'll let him speak for himself. I'll just give you the broad strokes. We asked him what he thought something like this would cost, and we asked him to come up with his idea of what he thought our fair contribution to the study would be. And basically, his conclusion, and I'll let him speak for himself again, is that it should be proportional to the amount of traffic that we are adding to the system as a whole. So, Kim.
Yeah.
Good evening. I'm Ken Hasbardian, traffic engineer for TEP LLC. What I did was a standard and typical proportion analysis, where we see what proportion of the traffic on the roads is related to this site. And the methodology used is very, very standard, very typical. We looked at key locations, Walker's Brook Drive north of John Street, Walker's Brook Drive south of Lakeview Avenue, Eaton Street, north of Pleasant Street. So basically looked at the main corridor, either side of Lakeview is what it boils down to, and then we also looked at Eaton Street. We looked at volume for the weekday AM peak hour, the weekday PM peak hour, and the Saturday midday peak hour, all those locations. If you look at the site traffic as a percentage of the total traffic in 2024, that percentage is 3.1%. We developed those numbers using the numbers in the traffic impact study for the 120 units. 86 units are now proposed, which reduces the peak hour site trips. We didn't take advantage of that reduction. And we also didn't take advantage of the fact that the existing site has some traffic, including construction-type vehicles. We didn't take advantage of that. So it was a conservative analysis in that sense. I'd be happy to answer any questions about the method I used.
Really, first and foremost, I would say the contribution that we're making for the treatment of 40B. And I would also note that when Green did their peer review, we also paid for that. And a large part of that was completely redoing a new traffic survey to confirm Kim's work. And in the process of that, Green has already studied a number of these intersections. So that's another contribution that I would consider that we've made to looking into these traffic problems. So we're willing to keep the conversation open with Chris and try to work out a number.
Okay. So this is to be continued, so let's move on. Next on the item was H on page 11, was lighting. I think you addressed the concerns of conservation on that. As I go through these, if somebody has, board members have concerns or questions or whatever, then, you know. So I just put more or less a check because that had been corrected. Staff-wise?
Yep.
I, landscaping and screening.
Team Conservation was happy to keep the screening with the existing trees and the mix of the arborvitae proposed. I believe we had tried to request perhaps some taller trees be planted initially. So I don't know where that stands, but I think on the plans it said 4 to 5 feet, so the Conservation that seems happy with that.
Okay, so we still may have some like what to do with that, perhaps.
Andrew, could you, do you mind repeating what you said? I couldn't quite understand what you're saying about.
So on the screening on Eaton Street, I believe in December we had discussed perhaps you guys planting taller arborvitaes to start with, more than the 4 to 5 feet, perhaps starting at like 6 to 8. But Conservation does not recommend you keep some of the existing trees there mixed with the arborvitaes, and as proposed you did 4 to 5 feet, so I don't know exactly where EDA stands on that, if they'd like higher trees or not, but Conservation was okay with the landscaping.
So, again, there's still, we haven't nailed down a lot of these little things,
right.
But I mean, we're in the right ballpark.
Right, yes, so exactly.
Retaining walls, next item on the list here. Again, was that?
Details were provided on the plan set. They still have the option of which type of wall they would prefer, so that's okay.
And I think Matt addressed that this evening, the changes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So I have that checked out. Open space, I think we've more or less taken care of the open space. Drainage, we have a letter that's coming in from the town engineer, but we haven't got that letter yet. So that's still on hold.
Mm-hmm.
Utilities, I think that was addressed on the latest control plan that we brought in.
That's right.
So I have a check out from there. Fire department, we addressed, and I think all the regulations on the fire department suggestion, especially on the traffic within the complexes.
Correct.
Do you have anything more on that, Nathan?
I do not have anything else on that.
Board member? Police department. We have a letter addressing it already, so I assume that that's been taken care of.
You were mentioning police.
Police, yeah.
Yep.
And I think that they that was addressed with the control plans issues in there too. Complete street policy. I'm not sure.
The locations were added to the site plan I saw on Chris's plans.
That was for the bike racks?
Yeah.
That was the only thing that was missing. So I have to check off. Signage. That was also, I think, addressed in the site, the control document.
Correct. There was, in our initial plans, that we actually filed a, I believe it was a rendering of what the sign more or less would look like. It was a 4x6 monument sign on the ground. Chris's new plans, I believe, show the locations on that. Is that correct? Do we need to? Okay.
double check that and make sure that they.
And then we have the addition of the note from the abutter on the taking down of the fence that goes along with that.
Yeah.
And we'll put it in there. And now we're looking at the waiver section. It starts on page 4. Andrew, did you see anything?
Nope, and I believe the applicants will be submitting a revised and final waiver list as we move forward.
Exactly.
So we'll review that once it's submitted.
Correct.
And that includes the clock. I come down to number 13 on the request.
I'll revise that
okay. To
address okay. The comments from the board tonight. I'll completely change that to just waive the parking requirement okay. Down to 1.36 okay. To allow 101 parking spaces, period.
Okay. And we move on to page 14. The conditions. I assume that these sheets you have turned in, that's up to date so far, what we needed?
Yes. Okay.
So we come down, the development aspect of it, that paragraph is as it stands now, that's the one that you revised. For the numbers of units and where they're located, right?
Correct. Yeah.
Okay.
And that reflects the current count.
Okay. Do we need to know, or should say, as Chris, do we need to provide specific locations for the affordable units within the complex? As part of the architectural plans?
You do not need to. And oftentimes that's the final locations, I believe, are determined. When they go back after they get their permit from you, when they go back to Mass Housing for their final, it's called final approval, that'll get pinned down permanently. Then what you often do see included in your decision is a requirement that they be spaced proportionally throughout the project, not bunched up in one location. And when I say spaced proportionally, that they go various floors and then ground the building ladder. Although backing up, I think what I heard tonight was that you're going to know where they're going to be, and we'll provide a plan to the board.
I mean, we can.
Okay.
I mean,
so
we have to figure out because eventually the design of the actual ADA compliant units and the ones that have to be oversized, the
yeah.
ADA, it's going to dictate part of that anyway. So
okay. So can you get include that with the materials that you get to the board before we whatever the next hearing date is before then? We'll copy the name of that plan into the decision.
Because that would just be easy enough to include in the architectural, but also in section 2 of the development on the approved plans and the conditions. Okay. So now we're on to three documentation on page 15. The hard copy, I mean, that goes without saying, I think we have a problem with that. We have a problem with that, right? Well,
sorry, what was the question?
Number 3, the documentation, the one hard copy.
Yep.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
The affirmative fair housing, that's, does it give you, right? Mm-hmm. Local preference, does it give me?
Mm-hmm.
Other permits, you don't know, so that you can throw them anyway, so that's a good one. Then we come down to number 7 on page 15. Building designs and materials. I think the applicant told us or mentioned what he was going to use or they were going to use. I didn't see that noted anywhere. Do we need to notate that?
If that's in the plan, if that's in the materials they submitted thus far, then yeah, we should be more specific about what we're saying. I confess, I can't recall what they
I think that was early on the project as it was given to the board. I don't remember the exact materials used. I know the color scheme was in there and so forth, but the actual materials that they were using. So that needs to be updated.
Maybe ask a question. Do we have exterior building materials in the...
We have the sense of what it is, but of course, you know, obviously we haven't fully designed the actual design of the building, so I guess the question would be is, we could provide this of what we, you know, foresee using. However, that could be subject to not mass change, but slight change depending on the final design. So I think it just needs to be clarified. We put it in there, not, you know, is it block and stone, or do we have latitude to make certain, you know, design changes along the way? So I think that would be the concern. I mean, we can definitely give you a list of what we're thinking right now, as long as it's in that general ballpark, and we'll be fine.
That could be a representative list of...
Yeah, something like that.
Utilities. I mean, that's standard. You also referenced that before Dr. tonight, too. And you still need to speak with the engineer from Trading and Municipal Lighting.
And was that all? We have the locations of the transformers, but the final design
is still pending.
That comes later.
Okay. I think Bill said we got that?
Yep.
Okay. Electric, again, that's. Sewer, where are we on the sewer?
As far as I know, I haven't heard from, besides Ryan's memo, which he's worked with Chris, so he seems to be up to date for that.
So the lift station is still part of it? We don't know the location or the design?
We know.
If you have any improvements, that goes with the roadway, reconstruction of the roadways, mm-hmm. standards. Yeah, I think both the applicant and the staff is on the same page on that, mm-hmm. and their wording is okay.
Mm-hmm.
We talked about the number 12, the Walker's Brook Drive Road and intersection analysis and redesign, so we know that that's on hold. We're looking at that now. Town Council and staff are working on that. Plan changes, that's a mass housing thing. Next one is prior to the commencement of the work site, the district for demolition permit. Stormwater operation and maintenance plan. Is that
Okay.
We're over to 17. On engineering concerns. Dating back to their memo of 12/5/18.
That's a standard condition we put in, and Brian and our department will work with Chris to address any of those concerns throughout the process.
Yeah, we've already
run through the list. I'm going to run through the list. Okay. So all this is going to be back in staff's staff anyways. Anyways. Construction schedule and staging plan. I had questions on that. I don't know if that's exactly what you want. Gina wants to weigh in on that too.
I mean, this is how we've done it with other projects. We get a construction management plan. We have a schedule. Everything's in writing, how it's going to be conducted.
Okay.
The one point that I would emphasize on this is, again, communication. whether it makes sense to have a project website or however to get the information out on the disruption related to the construction. And I've seen it done a couple different ways, but communication is critical to letting people know when you're going to have road closures, when you're going to have other things that are going to be a nuisance to the neighborhood. So we're happy to work with you on that so that we can make it as smooth as possible. And the construction hours, we'll have a pre-construction meeting and emphasize the importance of that, but the problems we've run into in the past are mostly related to early start times, and we just can't have that. The workers can arrive at 6:30, but they cannot start work until 7 a.m. And that's where we get most of our problems.
So we might want to refine that a little bit.
I mean, it's the town bylaw that stipulates that, the general bylaw. I don't know how you can, we go over it and over it and over it, and it'll be, I assume, in the construction management plan, but that's probably the biggest thing, that and the road closures.
So we'll work on that?
I mean, maybe we want to put the actual hours of the decision.
I don't know, that's up to you.
Yeah.
I mean, that seems to be a problem all the time.
Yeah.
That and where the workers are parking and all the rest of that. That's an issue. I mean, that's the management on your side of it. So. But the enforcement is very tough. It's tough on both the applicant and tough on the staff.
Yeah, we spent a lot of time chasing this, and it's really not a good use of staff time.
Gene, would you like some reference to the town's bylaw that pertains to the hours of construction? I know that the bylaw does specify hours and a procedure for if you need to get extensions on hours in certain circumstances. Can you make a reference to it?
I repeat, the bylaw is not that complicated.
Yep.
It's like one paragraph. I reference it and repeat it in the decision. That way it's crystal clear.
That's fine. It's on the books. We're required to comply anyway.
Yep.
Pre demolition meeting. I don't know what is involved in that.
That usually occurs around the time they come for their permits, and we'll just coordinate a time with them and meet with town staff, public safety, and all of us to discuss their process and standard procedure.
So that's the first of the permits that they're going to be requesting.
Right.
Mr. Chairman. Would it be possible to get a neighborhood representative to that pre-demolition meeting?
I think in the past, that's strictly staff. I mean, you've got to put trust someplace, and I think the staff is it's difficult because they have the final say, and the applicant has got to follow through. So having a third party is kind of difficult.
Maybe one way to do it is just if there are any concerns, just send them along, and we'll bring them up.
We got their construction management plan and schedule, and that's
basically it.
Yeah.
And that's reviewable prior to that meeting.
Usually we get it at the meeting.
Right.
Everything's public.
Yeah.
We actually put it on the website.
Right.
It would just be hard to express some concerns if we don't know what's going to happen. So maybe I was just thinking representation at the meeting
you know, anything red flag comes up, we could vocalize it right then.
Yeah, there's pros and cons to that.
I'm sure. Something tends to crash.
Yeah.
Article page 17, prior to the issuance of a building permit and start of construction. The board has, in all of its new construction, whether it's a single family, an addition of a garage, or whatever, it says that there is a, we have a two paragraph insert in its foundation plan requirement. And the foundation, you must have a foundation plan permit, and then after the foundation is poured, before you can move on to the second, an as-built is done to make sure that it sits on the right side.
We've actually just come up with something a little bit different recently.
That's fine.
Yeah. We are now conditioning. We issue the full building permit, but we issue it with a condition that no vertical construction can happen until we receive and verify the foundation as built. So we don't hold up the applicant, we are issuing the full building permit, but it's with that condition so that we keep control of that.
And just so the board knows, that's standard operating procedure.
I don't think we've ever before put that into the large projects, and it can come back and bite you. So the board has always done that in the past for small, single unit type of thing. So the final plan of record, you're going to put in your own suggestion on that. Okay. And then, of course, the final approval by Mass Housing. We do all this work and Mass Housing doesn't approve it. We have to come back and modify it or whatever. So. On page 18 then, vacant property bylaws. You're going to have to help me with some of this stuff. Now you're getting into it.
The vacant property bylaw is a general bylaw, and what we stipulate is that any vacant properties are maintained to a certain standard. And it gets a little tricky with construction projects because, you know, we don't want to add to the burden of the property owner trying to develop the property, but at the same time, we don't want to see these sites become unsightly. So the best way we can handle this is to be upfront that if there were some extenuating circumstance and the site were vacant longer than anyone would expect, we would have that general bylaw as a tool to go back to and say, we need this property to be maintained to this level. And we could use that to begin doing enforcement efforts. We don't want to. Again, it's a huge drain of staff time that, you know, the project's going to be developed. But it's a little bit of an insurance policy that we can keep our eye on the property and that it's maintained properly.
I have reviewed that bylaw. It's fairly straightforward.
Yep.
As well.
It's not very
to make sure that it's not a giant hole in the ground that someone's going to fall into.
There's
provisions about paving for permit and that sort of thing. Standard stuff.
That's really a worst case scenario that if for some reason a snag on this.
You with the board? Okay. Next one is the development review team comments. Really going back to October 3rd, 2018, and it seems that both parties have agreed on that.
Mm-hmm.
our peer review recommendations for the final design.
That the peer review is mostly resolved. I think Chris is still waiting for that letter from Matt Rosario.
He said that he's got the details of that small change in his own water, and I expect that he will issue something final.
Okay, so we're still holding on that, but we're waiting for the letter to come in. Building and fire code consultants, building code plan review, building code concerns, fire code plan review, fire code concerns, regulatory and use agreement. Oops. So 6 through 10 are just code issues. And you're all in agreement on that?
Yep. Mm-hmm. We have an outside code review consultant that reviews for the building code, the handicap code, the energy code, and the fire code. And that is something that we pass along to the applicant as far as the cost goes.
Okay. We were expecting that. That was discussed when we were board mayor member discussing the scope of the engineering.
Regulatory agreement, use agreement, as again a mass housing issue. Utility meters. Did we have the utility meters up here in the findings? Because you're going to use the utility meters within each of the buildings.
Sorry, Mr. Chair, you're asking if there's another condition somewhere else or
yeah, I thought we addressed the utility meters in one of the findings earlier. Well,
don't believe so.
Well, yes, there is.
It says utility meter runs to be provided in the 50-unit apartment building and the 12-unit apartment building get permitted by utility providers.
So, okay, so that would be just another. Also that, okay.
So we should put the, I think you're right, we should put that in the condition. We should duplicate that in the condition as well.
Okay. Yes.
Okay, as long as the utility coming across is good.
Exactly.
Yeah, it'll be flexible. So it'll, or contingent.
Yeah.
You'll get it.
As I understand it, Chris, just the only thing we're talking about doing here is reproducing the same language as elsewhere in the decision already.
Right.
Here as well. So
implication.
Yeah.
Okay.
So no new requirements here. Just clarification.
There's a statement in the findings that says utility meter rooms will be provided in the 50-unit apartment building and the 12-unit apartment building if permitted by the utility providers. We'll just duplicate that in the conditions so it's enforceable. Although I don't know if it needs to be in the conditions, but there's a room on the condos for utilities as well. But it's shown on the plan, so I don't know if the condition is talking about that.
And my next one is rooftop mechanicals. Have we agreed on the screening? For I know that all the mechanicals are going down to the roof, especially for the front two apartment, smaller apartment buildings, since they are the lower ones and going to hide some of the screening of the large room of the rear. Is that something we have to come up with, or?
I confess, I don't recall if we've seen any depictions in the plans as to what the roof
is. We haven't designed mechanical systems yet. But if there was anything on the roof, it's not going to be. It's a small package, but they'll either be clear of the sight lines that you can't see them, or they'll be screened. Or if they're on the ground, you have to be screened. So it's vital that we adhere to that.
Well, just to that point, you know, you provide the appropriate screening. We've had issues coming from the board on just that particular issue. Transformer, that's been already depicted on the control document again, duplication.
But actually, the condition is currently reads, I think, wrong from what we heard Chris say tonight. It currently reads, three transformers have been proposed, one within lot A and two within lot B. It's now three within lot B.
Good catch. So we have the ADA and the AD certification. I assume that that's standard.
Yeah.
I&I fees, that's been agreed upon already.
That's going to be part of the town's requirement based on the number of bedrooms as a calculation.
Okay, so that's just meeting the standard. Pre-construction meeting, we've already addressed that. Now we're down to during construction hours. Well, we've already discussed that. We would probably just put that back in a bit.
We'll cut and paste the language of the from the bottom, the hours bylaw, right into the description.
Okay. Construction activities, well, that's spelled out.
Yes.
Construction dumpsters. I assume that's, you don't want the dumpsters overloaded, and you don't want Gene coming down on you either, or a designee. So I'm sure that would be careful. Site inspections, coordinates with town officials. Let me know if there's something here that you want to.
Nope, we're doing good.
I mean, this is pretty much all staff stuff, so. Water services, page 20. I have no idea what the rest of this is. on the certification points. Property management, that's something that needs to be addressed, I would assume, on a regular basis, making sure that staff and development team are on the same page, especially on the trucks coming in and going out, loading and unloading. The snow management, we've already talked about the trash recycling.
And I think we want to add in page 19 under property management some reference to requiring a parking management plan, which I don't think is in here right now. And it'll be, I think, based on what I heard earlier, it can be flexible. The applicant can come up with their own parking management plan. It just needs to be reasonably calculated to allow the 101 spaces to work properly.
Excellent.
Mr. Chair, there may be a reference to the parking management plan, I think, specifically in regards to the loading zones.
with that air vessel stormwater. We'll have a parking management plan. Signage, we've already done a good portion of the signage as part of the control document, plan of the work, and the recommendation by the police. And does this address signage on the property dictating where the different buildings are, entryways, and whatever, what size and shape? I mean, we got, if I remember, I keep saying a 40-page signing bylaw.
Yeah, it's pretty rough.
Directional signage does that.
Does this take care of all of that?
Yeah, a lot of our signage, even though it looks cumbersome, the, you know, enters here and all that, is it's in the sign bylaw, but they're not going to be subject to that as a 40B.
Okay.
So it would be good to know as much detail as possible on where those signs are going to go. I know you're going to have a monument sign, but I'm sure you'll have additional signage.
Architecture, we talked about those with the plans and the materials or whatever. Is that just a duplication there? Or okay. And prior to issuance of a final certificate of occupancy, that's pretty standard for staff on any occupancy, right?
Mm-hmm.
Same thing with recording. I don't know what about as-built bond and as-built plans. I assume that that's
standard.
Standard. Right? In there.
Conditions for ongoing operation, maintenance, and occupancy. Would you leave number one?
Yeah.
Okay. Lighting, we've already got that corrected on the control document that came in. And now it's conservation related. Or is that other lighting? So that's just... You guys didn't have a problem with that, did you?
No, I think we'll just need the spec sheets when we get to that.
Yeah. That's all.
That's a loaded word.
Chris and I are just discussing the implications of the language for each of dark sky initiatives. Do you think you can talk more about that?
Right, so we did present our photometric plan that we had a while back, and I did some pretty detailed information on the lumen output for the lights and a photometric, you know, pattern that shows the lumen levels, you know, approaching zero as you get closer to the plot line. So our understanding is that photometric plan is okay as presented.
Yeah, I think what we talked about was sometimes with LED lighting, even though the photometrics work, it can be such a white light that it seems it's a bigger impact.
The project's
so
yeah.
We talked about that and the degree Kelvin value is something that we have reduced over time, having learned that we don't want to see that blue light effect. Where a lot of planes early on when they were first coming out were as high as 4,000 or 5,000, we are consistently designing systems at 3,000 now, which brings you away from that blue light spectrum. A dark sky, That's a loaded phrase, because I don't know if you can exactly, say that something is dark sky compliant necessarily. But I'll take a look at our photometric analysis, and the person in the office will help me put it together to see if we can clarify that in some way.
Yeah.
And number three, the operation and maintenance plan. That's the one that we talked about that involved anything from parking to whatever. We don't have that yet. So that's what we're going for now. Hazardous materials, I assume that that's standard.
Yep.
Stormwater operation and maintenance.
Mm-hmm.
At that standard, we have that already.
Yep.
Project control. Is that a standard also for 40Bs?
Yes.
On page 22. And then an assignment, designation.
Yep, and that and the next one are both boilerplate.
That's a boilerplate?
Yep.
Successor, same thing, right?
Yep.
Okay. Look at this. Ooh, back to the signature page. So, basically, what we have, I think, is the issues that we have recorded, which I think we all have, and unless there is some other questions that we want to get answered or concerns that we want to make, I think our next order of business is to determine our next meeting.
Can we ask a quick question? And we don't need to do it now, because later. I just wondering if town council can maybe explain next time the insubstantial versus substantial change, because there's so many details in this decision. So I'm just wondering what is really subject to change and what is kind of more important.
I can't anticipate what the applicant will change about its project down the road, either while it's building it or before it starts to build it or after it's done. But they can always come back in and ask for a modification of their permit. And if they do that, the first question is whether it's insubstantial or substantial. If it's insubstantial, it's automatically approved. If it's substantial, there's a public hearing and the board has to think further about whether or not it should be approved or not. In either case, the applicant, if it doesn't like the board's decision, can take an appeal to the house. There are lists in the DHCD regulations about what are automatically substantial changes and what are automatically insubstantial changes. So there's some guidance as to what, which is which, but they're not helpful in the sense of the changes the after is proposed are usually different than the examples that are given. So adding some examples are increasing the number of units by some amount but less than 10%. Is insubstantial. Increasing the height of a building by a certain amount, but less than a certain percentage, is insubstantial. So there are what you would think of as significant changes to the project are automatic, or are in some cases automatically insubstantial because of the HD system. But again, the examples are usually not helpful.
Requesting that they specify materials, colors, everything, those are not really binding.
That's why the decision, those conditions are often drafted with some flexibility for the applicant. Because if you pin them down too specifically, they'll come back in for what is really, in some cases like that, not as
important. So I just want to, I know it won't happen again, but like what was decided last week, does it mean going forward, like changing that is automatically not substantial? Is that precedent now?
The board will review each and every change on a case-by-case basis. So that
are you talking about this decision?
I was just
are you talking about something in the future?
No, I was wondering because it's not
very long and involved. You don't want, I mean, there's so many different combinations, and Chris can tell you, being in the business. But I'd like to go on to finding another appropriate time for the board to meet to continue this, and we have enough time. We're already on board for the 30th, which is next Wednesday. Is that sufficient time to get some of the things that we're talking about in, or do we need to move forward to a date in February? I really would love to get this done by the 22nd so that we can officially sign it and get it out. Even though we have a 30-day addition, I don't want to go really beyond that. If we can in any way possibly get by that.
I'm concerned that the 30th might not be quite enough time for us to get everything back.
I agree with that. And I don't want to overstep my place here or be overly optimistic, but I guess what I would suggest is that we, without extending it too far, give the applicant enough time to get the board literally everything
else that we need.
Else that it is suggested. There's not, and I don't want to come up, but I think at the next hearing, we really ought to have every last piece of paper we're ever going to need from the applicant and a new draft decision from me so that we can optimistically maybe talk about closing the hearing. Again, I don't want to overstep, but at a minimum, I think we're down to a short enough list of items from the applicant that we should get it all in and not have to turn to them for any more information, hopefully, after the next session.
Just so you know, the 18th is a holiday, February 18th, so.
The first Wednesday in February, a week set up for other hearings?
So we have nothing scheduled in February. We've kept it pretty clear. Okay. And the one application we have is not quite ready yet to be booked, so we're ready for February at any date. Cy is absent from February 1st to the 16th, but in case of emergencies, he has not missed a meeting yet, so he could miss and review. Right. So just however the board feels about that and would like to proceed.
Well, Cy's already said that he doesn't mind fulfilling the Mullen rule this last one. So,
I'll be gone from February 1st through February 15th.
Mm-hmm. So I can do the 6th if that's enough time for the applicant to get over.
Then Jesse, what is the time for you?
I just spoke before we got here with Ted, and he asked me to steer clear of the 6th and the 7th because that's when he's having his other eye surgery. I was going to make a suggestion, and that would be that maybe we don't even need a special meeting just for this. We could go on to the regular agenda of the board on the 20th, which would come in right before the deadline, the previous deadline of the 25th, I believe it was.
27th.
Okay.
I can do the 20th.
That night is the board's regular meeting, so be put on the agenda wherever you see fit. We could also do the 14th if you're inclined to keep a special meeting night. Ted and I are available the 12th and the 13th of that week.
We could do the 13th if the board feels that's
what?
The 13th.
I could send a substitute, but I'm booked for another 40B hearing on the 16th. On the 13th, sorry.
On the 13th. That means we really would have to be on target, which means you're going to have to work closely with the staff, Jesse, to make sure that all this stuff is ready. And if we go the
20th.
What would be the 20th then?
Mm-hmm.
Go to the 20th, we're just about ready to ink it in within.
And I think we are very close with that. And if worse comes worse and there are a few more details, we did submit the letter extending into March, so we have a little buffer, although I understand that the chair would like to stay within the time.
Well, the only reason I'm saying that is because nobody has ever been in this situation before. We don't know what Mass Housing would do.
Yep.
We'd have to talk to them, but the suggestion would be just go forward and get it done and just pass it in, even if we do go beyond the 22nd, but why look down that road if we don't have to?
Agreed. I think we can get it wrapped up.
February 20th. Accept the motion to move the subject matter of this hearing from the 20th of February. This room, or?
Sure.
We can, we could probably go back to the town hall.
We probably, that also might be a conservation date, I'm trying to think. So I think it's safer to have it here, where we've been consistent.
Just one question for your purposes, Andrew.
What was that?
Have you already noticed hearing with the board?
Nope, we have nothing on that agenda.
The 20th, it's going to be. Okay. So, I'm going to make a motion.
Yeah.
So move.
Second.
All in favor of the 20th? 500. No worries about that. Continue until the 20th.
So just a note to the board, you will not have a meeting on the 6th. We have nothing on the agenda. Right? Unless you guys want to do minutes, but.
I think Gene loves to come out for these meetings.
Yes, I do.